Hi, welcome to La Iglesia en el Camino. We are very happy that you are joining us today for our online service, because I am sure the Lord has something special in store for you. Psalms 40:16 says, "But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you." So I invite you to prepare your mind and your heart to receive the message of our pastor. But first, let's exalt the name of our Lord together.
Thank you for joining us today. It's a pleasure to have you with us today. I want you to worship with us. I want you to praise his name. So come on and put your hands together like this. Here we go. Oh, I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. Signs and wonders. Oh, I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Oh, my praise belongs to you forever. Come on, sing with us. This is my testimony from death.
Doing today? I'm glad to be together worshiping God with our songs. But it gives me more joy to be able together to be faithful to God with our tithes and offerings. The dynamic that God establishes in His Word is that He gives us blessings. And when we are faithful and obedient to Him, He blesses us even more. And the work of God here on earth continues. In the Bible, God commands us to bring our tithes and offerings to the church so that His work continues and so that you and I might be blessed. Today, I want to encourage you to decide what are you going to give to God, and while you decide in your heart what you are going to give to God, I want to pray. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to adore you with our tithes and offerings. I declare a blessing on each person who has decided to give out of obedience for your work. In the name of Jesus, amen. Remember that there are different ways to give. You can find them in our website or in the description below in this video. May God continue to bless you.
up your hands and sing this with me. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Can you sing this with me again? Your presence is an open door. So come, love, Lord, like never.
Welcome. My name is Nestor Flores, and I am so glad you're joining us, and I want to thank you for making time to be with us. We are in a series of messages where we're talking about marriage, specifically how to renew our marriage. And we're doing this because, see, every marriage begins with big dreams and great expectations. But what happens is that the struggles, the difficulties, the problems, the simple demands of life, they begin to dim that glow that couples had when they first began. And that's the importance of renewal. Because when renewal happens, it revitalizes the passion. It revitalizes the attraction, the romance, the love. And couples can become united and happy. And couples can stay united and happy. Which, by the way, it's God's intention for marriage. But before we continue any further, what do you say we start with a little bit of humor and then we'll jump right into today's message? The joke says that a man went to go visit his dear mother at the funeral. And when he was at her tomb, he laid the flowers and he's there just giving her her respects. And when he was getting ready to go back to his car, his attention was attracted by another man in another tomb who was just crying and wailing. And he just couldn't take his attention. And this man was praying and crying with such passion, saying, "Why did you have to die? Why did you have to die?" The man couldn't help himself. And he went over to the man because he just had to know who it was that passed away that caused so much passion and pain in this one other man. As he approaches the man, he says, "Forgive me for interrupting, but I'm just overwhelmed by your passion and your pain for this loved one that you lost, that I just had to know, who was it? Was it a father? Was it a son? Was it a daughter? Who was it?" The man that was crying composes himself, and after composing himself, he replies to that first man and he says, "It was my wife's first husband." Let's pray. Some of you will get that joke in a couple of seconds. But let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you. Lord, our marriages, our relationships, they need you. So please renew us. May your word transform us. May your word bring life to the dead areas. May your word bring clarity to the areas where we meet, where we have confusion or we're not sure what to do. Lord, Father, we need you. We are asking you to renew us. We pray this in the wonderful name of your son, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Look at what Genesis 2, 22 through 24 says. It'll appear on your screen. It says, "Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib and he brought her to the man. At last," the man exclaims. So Adam shouted, "Finally," right? He says, "At last, this one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh. She will be called woman." Do you know why Eve was called a woman? Because when Adam first saw her, he went, "Wow, man." He was so impressed by her that he said, "Wow, man." So that's why she's called a woman. He says she will be called the woman because she was taken from man. Verse 24 says the following. "This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into" what? "One." In this passage, in the second chapter of Genesis, we see the first wedding. We see the first wedding take place when God gives Eve to Adam. And we have to remember that it was God who established marriage. Marriage is God's idea, it's not society's, it's not the United States of America's idea. No, it is God's idea. And in this passage, not only do we see the first marriage, but we see the purpose of marriage. And that is that that two individuals were to become one. You know, the joke says that all couples are trying to become one, but that the battle is in deciding which one they become. And see, in this passage, we see the first marriage and we see a union, a unity, a fusing of two individuals that takes place. But we also see that God says something very key. He says that this marriage is sacred and that it shouldn't be broken. So the question now becomes, if marriage is sacred, if marriage is God's idea, then why is it that we experience so much marital breakdown? Why is it that so many marriages end up in divorce in our days? Well, one definite answer is the enemy. The enemy of our souls, the devil. He's been very successful at breaking and destroying many marriages. Unfortunately, he's had much success in many relationships. And he's one reason that so many sacred marriages have experienced divorce and breakdown. And see, my hope and prayer are that through this series, we would learn, and I'm with you, I'm married, and I have to learn this from the Word of God, that we would learn how to constantly renew our marriage so that we can strengthen the unity in our marriage. Because when we do, when the unity is strong, we're gonna have a happy, satisfying marriage that will be for life. So let me ask you this. Do you want that? Do you want that? If you want that, I wanna challenge you to say that, especially if your spouse is next to you, to say, I want a happy, satisfying marriage that lasts for a lifetime. If you do, we need to understand that there's three areas that produce tension and stress in marriage. They produce it in all relationships, but especially in marriage. We've mentioned these in the past weeks, but you know, we're gonna keep repeating them because repetition is key. The first area of tension in every relationship, but especially marriage, is unaccepted differences. Let me ask you a question. How long into your marriage did it take you to realize that the person you married was nothing like you? They were very different from you. I think that happens in all marriages where we realize, you know, when we're dating, we tend to emphasize and focus on all the things we have in common. But when we get married, we realize, hey, these individuals are very different than me. And see, there's inconsequential differences as well as consequential differences. Inconsequential differences are differences like, well, you prefer one brand over another, or you prefer one brand of shoe over another, and they're inconsequential because they really don't make a huge impact in your marriage. But there's consequential differences, and these differences do have great consequences. Differences like a difference in goals, difference in values, difference in interests, difference in lifestyles. And see, every marriage has consequential differences. And the good news is that they can be solved. They can be solved in the coming weeks. I'm going to share each week one way that you can solve these differences. Let me share one with you today. If you want to ease the tension of differences in your marriage, the first thing you got to do is embrace differences. Embrace differences. See, having differences in marriage is normal. Let me tell you that the fact that you and your spouse are different is not because something is wrong. It's normal. And here's why it's normal. Because we are very different individuals. And it's a good thing that we are different individuals. So if you want to ease the tension of differences, the first thing you need to do is understand that being different is not bad. We have to change our paradigm concerning differences. See, the moment we change our mind from seeing our differences not as something bad, but as something positive, our marriage takes a whole different route. Do you know the difference between unity and and uniformity? Now, a lot of people use these words interchangeably, and they appear to be the same, but they're very different. And the biggest difference between these two words is that unity accepts differences while uniformity doesn't. See, unity refers to the union or harmony between different elements, between different individuals. Let me give you an example and then I'll show you a picture. An example of unity is a choir. A choir is made up of different voices, but they sing in harmony. They sing in unity. Now, let me show you a picture. Look at this picture. In this picture, you have different rocks. They don't look the same, but they're in harmony. They're in unity. And that's what unity is. Now, uniformity, while maybe similar to unity, it is not the same. Because uniformity points to a state of sameness. In other words, uniformity focuses on having the same shape, the same type, the same amount. Let me give you an example, and I'll also show you a picture. The example for uniformity is, have you ever seen those neighborhoods where all the houses have the same layout? They may have like a different shade of color, but basically they have the garage in the same place and they have the same type of windows. That's uniformity. Now, let me show you a picture of what uniformity looks like. In this picture, you see different individuals and they are different. But the goal is not embracing the differences. The goal is looking the same. And here's what you need to understand. The Bible says that in marriage, we are one. That two individuals become one. But it also says that that one unit is composed of one man and one woman who happen to be very different from each other. So to live in unity, to minimize the stress of differences, we have to learn to embrace differences. So the first tension is its differences. The second area of tension is unresolved offenses. And you know what? It's only a matter of time before your spouse offends you. I remember when my sister first got married a couple of months in, I said, so hey, have you guys had your first big fight? You know, and it's only a matter of time before we offend each other. And the reason I'm not excusing that, but the reason I'm saying that is because we're not perfect people. We make mistakes and we're gonna hurt each other. In fact, Jesus said that it was impossible that offenses would not come. Look at what Luke 17:1 says. Then he said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offenses should come. I want you to notice, first of all, it's Jesus speaking. And second, that he says, it's impossible that no offenses should come. And see, the saddest thing about this is that the worst offenders in your life are those closest to you. Your spouse, your kids, your family, and so on. So see, when we retain offenses, because they are going to happen, and while we may reduce them, we can't completely prevent them. But when they happen and we retain them, they create extra tension in our marriage. And there's also a solution for this tension, to forgive. We'll tell you more about that in the coming weeks. But let's look at the third area of tension. The third area is unmet needs. And see, every person has needs that they need to be met. Now, listen to me. You got to lean in on this. This is important. This is where our series is focused. Every person, if you're married, or if one day you're going to get married, or you want to get married, one of the reasons you're going to get married or want to get married is because you have needs that need to be met. And I can prove that to you because if we could meet our own needs, we wouldn't get married. But the fact that we can't meet them leads us to saying, I want to get married. And see, when these needs are not met, they create a lot of tension in our life. Last week, we talked about how every person has an emotional love bank. And when good deeds, when acts of love, when good things are done, withdrawals are made into that love bank. And when enough deposits are made, Our emotional love tank is full and we feel love. We are in love. But if only withdrawals are made, then our emotional bank feels empty. And that's when love begins to wane, begins to die, begins to disappear. And see, if your emotional love bank is on empty, if your emotional love bank is overdrawn, then to fill it again, you have to take the advice that is given to us in the Word of God, in the book of Revelations, chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. And look at what it says. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. To understand this verse more, I want to invite you to go back and listen to the message from last week. And God continues to say in that passage, if you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place among the churches. So the third area of attention is unmet needs. And in this series, we're going to look at the 10 main needs in marriage. 5 that most women would generally say, these are my top five needs. And then we're also looking at 5 that men generally consider the most important. We've already looked at the number 1 for each spouse. We've looked at the fact that for women, the number 1 need is affection, and that for men, their number 1 need is sexual intimacy. Today, we're going to look at the second need of most women. So I'm going to mainly refer to men, to husbands. But it doesn't mean that wives can tune out. Because you know what? Although generally speaking, these needs are predominantly in one gender, there are some men who would say, hey, this need of conversation is also a high need of mine. So don't tune out, because whether it's a big need or not in your husband, the truth is that it's a need. So we've said that to renew your marriage, we can renew our marriage by meeting the need, number 1 in women, of affection in the life of your wife. But today, we're going to talk about how to renew your marriage by meeting the need of conversation in the life of your wife. Look at what Philippians 2:2 says. Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and one purpose. You know, a study was made of children between the ages and 4 to 7, if I remember correctly. And in the study, they discovered that 100% of the noises that the little girls made had to do with conversations. But that the boys, the little boys, only 60% of the noises they made had to do with the conversation. The rest were just noises. And you're probably wondering, well, Pastor, what does that have anything to do? Well, that tells us that females, they value, they need talking more than we men do. You know, recently, not recently, but my wife and I, we both own some AirPods. I have my own pair and she's got her own pair. And I was thinking about this, just how interesting we are and how much of a need it is for women to talk, that I tend to use my AirPods to listen to music, to listen to an audiobook. I hardly ever have them on to talk to people. While my wife on the other end, that's the number 1 thing she uses them for. She listens to music, but not more than she uses them to talk to somebody. In fact, since I got her pair of AirPods, she talks more to people. And not because she has nothing to do, but because conversing, talking in women is a need. So what I want to do is I want to share with us men, why we need to talk to our wife, why conversation is essential in a relationship, and why it's a need that we need to meet in our spouse. You ready for this? Number 1, conversation is essential, number 1, to meet the 10 needs in marriage. If you are going to want to meet the needs of your spouse, the reason why you got married, what keeps your marriage united and strong and happy and for a lifetime, you are going to need to learn to talk. Look at what Philippians 2:4 says. Don't look out only for your own interests. And I think this applies to men more than it does to women in this context. But take an interest in others too. See, in the series, we're talking about those needs, right? And for example, we've mentioned that a woman's number one need is for affection. And the one of the strongest ways, one of the best ways to show your wife affection is by talking to her, by conversing with her. We saw last week that the number one need of most men is physical intimacy. And it's proven that when couples talk about sex, when couples converse about sex, that they have a better sex life. And just as talking improves the first two needs, it's also going to help you with the remaining eight needs of every marriage. So talking is essential to meet the needs of your spouse. But second, conversing is essential because it brings solutions that solve problems. It's important to talk. It's important to converse with your wife because it's going to help you to bring solutions to the problems. See, bad or no communication causes all kinds of problems. If you are not communicating, if you are not talking, or if your communication is poor or horrible, you have all kinds of problems. And you think you have all kinds of problems because you don't know how to communicate. And when you don't know how to communicate, it causes more problems. And it's a vicious cycle. See, when we don't communicate, here's why it causes problems. Because when we don't communicate, we then interpret. We then give our own meaning. We then give our own intention to the actions of other people. And we say stuff like, you know, you did that because all you want to do is get on my nerves. And perhaps he had a headache. Perhaps he had a stomach ache. Perhaps he had a bad day. But because you don't communicate, you interpret it with your own intentions and your own meaning. People often say, or couples often say, you know, you don't come with me anymore because you're embarrassed of me. And maybe they're just tired. Maybe they're not interested in the place you're going. Maybe it has nothing to do with you. But because you don't communicate, then it leads to other problems. And that's the importance of communicating. See, good communication can solve and prevent all kinds of problems. Look at what Proverbs 13:17 says. It says, whoever delivers your message can make things better or worse for you. In other words, depending on the messenger, depending on the ability of communication, things can get better or things can get worse. See, marriage is an association. And in order to have a strong marriage, you're going to have to agree. You're going to have to talk about those areas where you guys are different. In order to have a strong marriage, you're going to have to be able to talk about how do we manage money? How do we raise our kids? What kind of friends are we going to allow into our relationships? What are the goals that we're going to have? And if you do not talk, then those differences cannot be agreed upon. And that's why marriages dissolve. That's why marriages don't last. But third, conversation is essential to promote closeness and union. You know, talking to your spouse is essential for her as well as for you because it promotes and nurtures unity. It promotes closeness. Philippians 2:2 says the following, then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. Loving one another and working together, look at this, with one mind and one purpose. God's desire, God's intent is that we as married individuals would live together in unity. He wants us to love each other and to do life in such a way that it would appear that we have one mind and one spirit. And the only way this is going to happen is if we talk, if there's regular conversations between me and my wife. See, conversing, talking with your spouse, it's like the ligaments in your physical body. See, these ligaments, they join your bones together so that the body, this physical body that I have, can stand and move, can stand and have action. Without the ligaments that connect the bones in my body would become a pile of useless meat. I would be unable to move. And many couples are falling apart because they're not talking. Because the husband is not meeting the need of conversing with his wife. Now, I've heard husbands say, well, if she needs to talk so much, why doesn't she find another woman and they talk their ears out? Well, she can. And she should. Every woman should have other women that she can talk to. But listen to me, guys. Even if she does find somebody who she could talk to for hours, she still wants to talk to you. Because she wants to connect with you. She wants to feel united with you. She wants in the heart of the man that she loves. So even if she does find a talking buddy, she still needs you. Because remember, she married you. She fell in love with you. And even then, some men would push and say, well, if she needs a man, why doesn't she find a good friend of the opposite sex? And you know what? Some people have asked, is it good for a woman to have a good friend of the opposite sex? Well, it's definitely not a sin, but it's dangerous. It's dangerous. And I think that we as men would not want to risk this danger in our life. And here's why it's dangerous, because you have to remember women are auditory. They fall in love through their ears. And if this other individual is paying attention to her, and if this other individual is connecting with her through conversations, the danger is that she could fall in love with him. In fact, that's how many infidelities have taken place. So, bottom line, for couples to get close to each other, to feel united, they need to talk. Because talking is the ligament that joins them together. Last but not least, fourth, conversation is essential to build up her heart. Conversation, talking builds up a person. Did you know that? Look at what Ephesians 4:29 tells us. It says, don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and what? Helpful, so that your words would be an encouragement to those who hear them. And this applies to our kids. This applies to those of us that are leaders as we lead others, but especially to our spouse. See, most women feel that their husbands don't really talk to them. And most men would say, what are you talking about, woman? We do talk. But see, what we men refer to as talking is shallow, superficial conversations as to what are the kids going to do today? What's the weather going to be outside? That's not what women need. They need to connect to our heart. They need to connect to our spirit, to our soul. And one of the things that we need to understand is that men and women talk for different reasons. See, we men, we talk because we want to come up with solutions. We talk because there's something that we want to achieve. Women, they talk because the simple act of talking counts to them. Women, they feel appreciated and loved when they're able to talk to their husband. And their husband talks back to them. See, for women, conversation is the point. The very act of talking to her husband is meaningful to her. It builds her up. It encourages her heart. So the husband that finds time to talk to his wife builds her up. If you want a better wife, one of the ways you can build up a better wife, a better person in her, is by meeting her need of conversing with her. So here's what I want to do before we end. Would you rate yourself, whether you're the wife or the husband, would you rate yourself in regards to this need? On a scale of 1 to 10, how big of a need is this for you? And I want to ask you, as I did last week, that you would take time to share it with your spouse. Now, let me end with this. A bad marriage, a marriage that is dysfunctional and that doesn't work, is a marriage that's composed of two masters in love. A marriage that is ideal, that is enjoyable, that is awesome, and that lasts, is a marriage that is composed of two servants in love. Now, notice the difference. Two masters in love lead to a broken marriage. Two servants in love lead to a good marriage. I love an illustration that Pastor Jimmy Evans often tells in his messages. And Pastor Jimmy Evans talks about the difference between a heavenly marriage and a hellish marriage. And here's how he illustrates the difference. He says that in a heavenly marriage, you have to picture a banquet table with the best foods and an abundance of food, and God is there and the angels are there to usher you. And in this big banquet, there's people. But the people, instead of arms, they have utensils as arms. But these utensils are too big to scoop up the food and feed yourself. And he says that in a hellish marriage, it's very similar to a heavenly marriage, except that God is not there. But the abundance of food, the banquet, the table is there. The utensils are there. And what makes a heavenly marriage heavenly is that the individuals use the utensils not to try to meet their needs, which are impossible to meet, but to serve others, to meet the needs of others. In a hellish marriage, the individuals are selfish. They refuse to serve one another. And they rather see each other starve than to serve and meet each other's needs. The food is there, the banquet is there, but they don't have a servant's heart. So because of that, they starve and they starve others. And I want to tell you that you have what it takes to meet your spouse's need. The banquet table is set before you. Serve each other. Meet each other's needs. Husbands, I know that as we talk about talking with our wives, we say, but we're just not made that way. Well, you know, we Christians have an advantage. We have a great help, and that's the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit helps us to communicate with the Father, that in fact, he takes what is in our heart and in our mind that we can't conjure up in words, and he communicates it to the Father. And if the Holy Spirit can help us communicate with God, you don't think he can help us communicate with our spouse? So let's be Spirit-led. Let's be Spirit-dependent. Those moments when we'd rather watch TV or go lock ourselves in the garage over talking to our wives, let's lean our head. Let's lift our sight to God and say, Holy Spirit, would you help me to meet my wife's need? And to do it not begrudgingly, but to do it delightfully, and that I may also enjoy it. So I encourage you, if you want a heavenly marriage, use what you have to meet each other's need. We're going to do two things before we go. On the third Sunday of every month, we have an anointing service. And we're going to take some time to pray for you and anoint you and just pray for your needs. But before I do that, I want to take a short time to invite those of you who may be listening. Maybe you're listening to me and you don't have God in your life. You know about God, but you don't have him in your life. You don't have a relationship with God. You know, before you can improve your marriage, you have to improve your relationship with God. And because of Jesus, you can. The Bible tells us that Jesus died so that you and I could have access to God. And if you would like to invite Jesus into your life to first change you and then transform all your life, not just your marriage, it would be my pleasure in leading you in that prayer. right there where you are, would you repeat after me? Would you say, Heavenly Father, I come to you because I need you. I ask that you come into my life. Please forgive me for all the wrong that I've done, all the wrong that separated me from you. From today on, I want to follow you. I want to live for you. And I need you to change my life. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you made that prayer, I want you to know that now the Spirit of God lives in you. I want to encourage you, get in touch with us. We would love to be able to put some resources in your hand. We would love to be able to encourage you, pray for you, and we want to invite you, stay connected to the church. If you feel comfortable, come visit us. We are having services in person. We would love to have you with us. Well, we're going to take a short break. And I want to ask you to go and grab some oil. Hopefully by now you've already set some dedicated oil aside. But if you haven't, grab whatever oil you have. We're going to pray for it. And we want to take this time to pray for you, to pray for whatever is going on, to pray blessing over you, to pray protection over you. So go ahead and do that. We'll give you a few seconds to do that. And I'll come right back before we dismiss. If you already have the oil there, I want to invite you. The first thing we're going to do before we use it to anoint you and to bless you is that we're going to dedicate it unto the Lord. So I want to invite you to grab that oil right there. And whether it's olive oil, grape oil, whatever kind of oil, or you have a specific anointed oil, we just want to take this time to dedicate it unto the Lord. Would you join me? Heavenly Father, we want to take this time to recognize, Lord, that in essence, there's nothing special about that oil. But what makes it special, Lord, is your word. It's what you have decreed. So, Lord, we want to dedicate it aside. We want to set it apart, Lord, not to cook stuff, but, Father, as a symbol of your favor, as a symbol of your protection, as a symbol of your spirit in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Well, if you have that oil, what I'm going to do here is pour a little bit into this container. And I want to invite you to just dip your finger and then put this in your forehead. Just kind of put some oil in your forehead. If you were here in person, we would do that for you. And as I mentioned, the oil is symbolic, first and foremost, of the Spirit of God, of the presence of God. But second, it's also symbolic of God's favor, of God's authority. So that's why we use it. And I want to invite you. I don't know what need you have. I don't know what challenge or what big question you have before the Lord. But as I pray, I want to invite you that as you place the oil in your forehead, that you would have that in mind. I don't know, but I believe that God knows and that he will answer if we believe. Let me pray for you. Would you go ahead and put the oil in your forehead? Heavenly Father, your word tells us that nothing is impossible for you. So, Lord, your people are before you, and whether they need healing, whether they need provision, whether they need a fresh start, whether they need divine intervention, whether they need an answer from you, Lord, whether they need, Father, for you to open a door, whatever it is, Father, we take this time to come before you. Because you're a good, not just a good, but a good, good Father. And Lord, I pray that you would answer according to your will and according to their faith. Father, we know that you can still heal. We know that you can still move mountains. We know that you can still defeat enemies. We know that you, Father, can still open doors. We know that you can still renew. So I pray that whatever your people are asking for, that you would answer according to your riches and glory. Father, I anoint and I pray your protection upon every individual, upon every marriage, upon every family. I pray your favor upon them. I pray that what they do according to your will would prosper, would multiply 100-fold. We pray a special protection, Lord, during this pandemic upon your people. In Jesus' name, amen. and amen. Hey, we can't wait to hear of the testimonies as God answers your petitions, as God answers your prayers. So make sure you take some time to let us know. Make sure you let us know the things that God is doing. If this message has been a blessing to you, would you share it with somebody? Until next Sunday, may the peace of God guard your hearts and mind, and may His joy be your strength.
Greetings. It's good to be with you. Hey, after a very difficult year like the one we just had, we believe that this next year is going to be a year of renewal. Renewal in every area of our life. In particular, our relationships. That's right, our relationships. Do you know that the quality of our relationship is going to determine the quality of our life? Yeah, in every area. In your character, in your success, as well as in your happiness. That's why we're going to begin a new series of messages that we're calling Renewing Your Marriage. But this isn't just for people that are married. This is for single people that one day hope to be married. In fact, you're going to learn some things that are going to help you in the future. If you're married, this is a time for you to come and invest and be revitalized in the joy of your marriage. And if you're older, this is a series that's going to help you to be able to share with your kids and grandkids what the Word of God has to say about marriage and relationships. And so we invite you to be with us. February the 7th is when we're going to begin, and there's two ways that you can join us. You can join us online, either Facebook or YouTube, or even you can log into our website at laiglesienelcamino.org. Or you can come in person and enjoy the service with us. Whichever way, we hope that you join us, and we'll see you here.